In this video, we're analyzing a perfectly elastic collision between two carts, and they bounce off of each other using a Hooke's law spring. And the real emphasis in this problem is to use the center of mass reference frame to analyze the collision. So in part A, we're looking at the center of mass velocity and then transforming the initial velocities of the carts into the center of mass frame. In part B, we take advantage of the center of mass frame to figure out the maximum compression of the spring during the collision. And in part C, we take advantage of the center of mass frame to find the final velocities of each cart within the center of mass frame and then transform those into the lab frame to kind of get the final answer for the outcome of the collision. So this idea of center of mass velocity, this comes from a fact about the total momentum of a system of moving objects, and I'll post a link to the video where this was derived. The total momentum, I'll call that P net, is equal to the total mass of the system, so the mass of all the objects in the system added together, and we usually use a capital M for that, multiplied by the center of mass velocity. So as these two carts move along the track, the center of mass changes position, and the center of mass velocity is just tracking how fast the center of mass moves. So the way we use this is by plugging in the masses and velocities of the initially moving carts to get the net momentum. Then we're able to solve for the center of mass velocity. So the cart on the left, that's 250 grams or 0.25 kilograms. Moving with a positive 5.1 meters per second. The car on the right, we're going to give that a minus sign for the velocity, so we'll just move that out in front. 400 grams is 0.4 kilograms. And again, the speed is 1.5 meters per second, and the minus sign takes care of the direction. On the right-hand side of this equation, we have the total mass, which is 650 grams or 0.65 kilograms. And the only unknown here is the center of mass velocity. And when we solve for the center of mass velocity, we get 1.038, just keeping a little extra precision today, 1.038 meters per second. So that's tracking to the right at 1.038 meters per second. So the next part of the question is a little bit tricky. We have to find the initial velocity of each of these carts within the center of mass reference frame. What that means is we're going to run along to the right as this collision is occurring. We're going to run at 1.038 meters per second to the right. This makes the center of mass of the system look stationary in the new reference frame. So just to show our perspective here, we are now running to the right at 1.038 meters per second and observing the initial and final states of this collision. So from this new perspective of running to the right at 1.038 meters per second, the cart on the left, the 250 gram cart, that's going to look like it's moving slower. It was moving 5.1 meters per second to the right in the lab frame. Now we're sort of attempting to catch up to it. We're running to the right, and that makes it look 1.038 meters per second slower as it moves to the right. So this is going to be our new initial velocity. I'll call this V1 initial. It's going to be 5.1 minus 1.038. This gives us 4.062 meters per second. Now with the 400 gram cart, we get the opposite effect. So we're running toward that. It was moving to the left and we're running to the right. That makes it look like it's going faster to the left. So if I just speak in terms of magnitudes here, in other words, I'm writing down the speed of this cart and not worrying about the sign for the direction right now, V2 initial is going to be this initial speed of 1.5 meters per second to the left, plus an additional 1.038 meters per second added to that magnitude. And this gives us 2.538 meters per second. So in parts B and C, we're going to get some useful results out of applying the center of mass frame to the problem. And the real power of the center of mass frame is that the net momentum is zero within that frame. And we can see that from our original equation for the center of mass velocity. The net momentum is equal to the total mass times the center of mass velocity. In the center of mass frame, we're observing the experiment from a frame that tracks with the center of mass. And that means the center of mass velocity is zero in that frame. And that means the net momentum is zero. So I want to take a moment just to show that, just to verify that the net momentum is zero within the center of mass frame. And then we're going to apply that fact to quickly solve the rest of the problem. So within the center of mass reference frame, the momentum of the first cart, and I mean the 250 gram one, is going to be 0.25 kilograms. And we're going to take our center of mass, initial velocity, 4.062 meters per second. And this gives us 1.016 kilogram meters per second for the rightward momentum of the first cart within the center of mass reference frame. We do the same thing for the second cart, P2 initial. That's 0.4 kilograms. And it has a leftward momentum. And again, we're just talking about the magnitude of that right now. It had a speed of 2.538 meters per second. And this gives us 1.014 5 kilogram meters per second. And of course, if we were including the direction, that would be negative. So these two quantities are practically equal. There's a little discrepancy due to rounding differences. I have a positive momentum to the right for that first cart that has the same magnitude of the leftward pointing momentum for the second cart. And my net momentum turns out to be 0. And the reason this is exciting is that collisions where the net momentum is 0 turn out to be particularly easy to analyze. So again, in part B, we're trying to find the maximum compression of this spring. And when does this occur? It occurs when the kinetic energy is at a minimum. And in fact, because I know the net momentum is 0 within this reference frame, I can figure out the minimum kinetic energy. It's when both carts are completely stationary. So it's really what we're looking at in the second picture on the left. During this impact, I actually have V1 is equal to 0 within the center of mass reference frame, V2 equals 0 within the center of mass reference frame. I know this is going to happen because I see immediately that that's one way of having 0 momentum within the center of mass reference frame. So within this frame, the kinetic energy is 0 at the moment of maximum compression of the spring. And all of that kinetic energy has gone into the potential energy within the spring. So we have an energy conservation problem where we start with our initial kinetic energies within the center of mass reference frame using the speeds that we found in part A. We set that equal to the spring potential energy with an unknown compression length, and we solve for the compression length. So symbolically, real quick, we have the potential energy in the spring, 1/2 kx². This is going to be equal to our initial kinetic energy in the first mass plus the initial kinetic energy in the second mass within the center of mass reference frame. So we plug the numbers in. We were told the spring constant was 70 newtons per meter. The compression distance x is the only unknown here. The initial kinetic energy of the first mass is going to be 1/2 times its mass, that was 0.25, times its speed squared, 4.062 squared. And then I have a 1/2 times 0.4 for the second mass, times 2.538 for the speed, all squared. So of course we can multiply through by 2 to clean things up a little bit. We smash all the numbers together on the right, divide by 70 and square root the result, and we'll get our compression distance. And we end up with a compression distance of 0.309 meters. And it might be nicer to write that in centimeters. That's 30.9 centimeters. Finally, in part C, we're going to apply the power of the center of mass reference frame to basically guess the final velocities of these carts within the center of mass frame. And then we're going to transform back to the lab frame. So again, the net momentum of the system is 0 within the center of mass reference frame. And what we're trying to do is find the outcome of a perfectly elastic collision within that frame. We know the initial momentum is 0. We know the kinetic energy is conserved. And if we can guess a solution that makes it so the final momentum is equal to the initial momentum and the final kinetic energy is equal to the initial kinetic energy, that solution is guaranteed to be correct. And there is an easily guessable solution. All we have to do is send the initially rightward moving mass back to the left with the same exact speed it started with. So 4.062 meters per second within the center of mass reference frame. Send the heavier mass, the 400 gram one, back to the right with exactly the same speed that it started with in the center of mass reference frame. That simply changes the sign on each of their momenta, making it so the net momentum is still 0. And by giving the same speed to each of the same masses, that makes the kinetic energy come out the same. So that's really the whole point of the center of mass reference frame, is it makes elastic collisions guessable. So within the center of mass reference frame, and I'm going to go ahead and talk about these, including their direction now. So I'll go ahead and put a vector hat on V1 final. That's going to be negative 4.062 meters per second, just meaning 4.062 meters per second to the left. V2 final, it was initially moving to the left before the collision occurs. It's now going to move to the right. So I'm going to write plus 2.538 meters per second. Again, we've already verified that the momenta of these two things turns out to be the same. So all we've done here is reverse the directions. We have the same magnitudes of the momenta, opposite signs, so the momentum still adds to 0. Secondly, these objects have the same mass as they originally did and the same speed as they originally did, so the kinetic energy is also the same. So there's our guessable solution to the elastic collision within the center of mass reference frame. Now the challenge is to convert back to the lab frame. And remember, the center of mass reference frame is the way we see the world when we're running to the right at 1.038 meters per second. V1 final has a leftward velocity of 4.062 meters per second. From that perspective, and remember, a leftward velocity is exaggerated when you're running to the right, so we need to reduce that effect. we're going to reduce the magnitude of this speed by 1.038 meters per second. Algebraically, what we're doing is adding the 1.038 to this velocity. And we end up with a velocity in the lab frame of negative 3.02, just keeping 3 sig figs for our final answer. And of course, the units are meters per second there. Now, what about V2 final? So within the center of mass frame, that's when we're running to the right at 1.038 meters per second, we see V2 moving to the right at 2.538 meters per second. Now remember, if we're running to the right, a rightward velocity has been underestimated. So we need to add in that magnitude of 1.038 meters per second. So we have 2.538 plus a 1.038 to figure out what it looks like from the lab frame. And again, to three significant digits, I have 3.58 meters per second. Now, if this all seems a little bit suspicious to you, changing into a new reference frame and turning an elastic collision into a guessable problem and then changing back, remember that any solution that conserves momentum and conserves kinetic energy is going to be the right answer for this elastic collision. So the way to check your work on this problem is to look at the final velocities for the lab reference frame. So again, we end up with the smaller cart reflecting and moving to the left at 3.02 meters per second. The larger cart also reflects from its original direction and it ends up moving at 3.58 meters per second to the right. So to check our answer here, we just compute the total initial momentum within the lab frame, compute the final momentum within the lab frame and make sure they come out the same, and then compute the total initial kinetic energy in the lab frame, the final kinetic energy in the lab frame, and make sure those come out the same. So I actually ran those numbers this afternoon and it does all check out. Just one final comment here. I think this problem is such a great window into the way that physicists think about the world. If we just did the lab frame analysis of this problem to figure out the final velocities of our masses, there would have been a heck of a lot of algebra in there. There's a nonlinear system of equations that has to be solved. So instead, we opted for a trade-off that was a little bit abstract and difficult. We had to imagine what the world looked like running to the right at 1.038 meters per second. But the trade-off is that all the algebra went away and the answer to the problem became guessable. Then we just had to transform back into the lab frame and we got our final answers. So I hope this video makes it a little more likely for you to consider using a transformation to a new reference frame to analyze a collision problem. I posted a link to a playlist on the left with some more center of mass and collision problems, and I'll see you next time.